Welcome to the Reality Revolution Podcast. This is your host, Brian Scott. This podcast is dedicated to the spirits who believe that life is meant to be magical and fun. We believe that humans are multidimensional, infinite, and eternal. And this podcast's primary purpose is to reawaken your sense of fascination and awe towards life, to shatter your rigid belief systems and habitually negative ways of seeing the world. So here in episode 2, I want to discuss a little bit of the idea of quantum physics and parallel realities. A lot has been written about this, and you see references a lot to parallel realities on TV, in the movies, and in books, and in science fiction. If you go back to episode 1, I gave a little bit of background of where I'm coming from. I had this completely insane thing that happened to me where I had people that came into my house, a home invasion, and they had shot at me and a bullet bounced off of my back. And the days following that, I started to believe that I had entered into a parallel reality. Many years before that, I had gone through a spiritual awakening, attempting many different meditation techniques, and had been utilizing something called quantum jumping, which meant exploring the idea of moving in and through parallel realities. And at the time, I thought it was a novelty, interesting. Maybe I was just being creative, but I didn't quite know if it was actually real. I had incredibly vivid visualizations that occurred at the time of my meditations before this event. And afterwards, I started to see incredibly bizarre changes in my world. My kids seemed a little bit different. The environment I was in was different. There were different buildings, different objects around me, different friends that were contacting me. My business had changed a tiny bit. Enough that I questioned myself and questioned my sanity. I questioned whether or not I had gone through some kind of post-traumatic stress disorder or had hallucinated this. And as somebody who's a huge fan of science fiction, I probably was just taking something that had happened and creating this bizarre backstory that was probably not true. And I went on this long journey that I tried to discover what had happened and to learn more about parallel realities and quantum physics. And the more that I read, the more interesting this became. And I'd like to share some of what I learned in this process. Of course, we use the word quantum all the time. There's a quantum realty that's right next to me. I've seen a quantum coffee shop. We kind of throw that word out, and in many ways, it kind of takes away some of the power behind it. Quantum, the word, was created by Max Planck back in the 1900s, and it's really about identifying small subatomic particles, quantum objects. The word quantum, in many cases, is used as a definition of measurement. We don't need to go into a full explanation of quantum physics. I know your brain is probably turning off right now. There's always that when you start to hear these topics discussed. I meet many people and I can just see their eyes glaze over. No math is being discussed. I am not a quantum physicist. I have tried to digest as much as possible. I've talked to physicists. I've interviewed them. I've read hundreds of books to try to fathom in perspective of what had happened to me. So that is where I'm coming from. And so I don't want you to expect a long diatribe about quantum physics. The first thing that is important to discuss is the idea of the double slit experiment. You probably have heard about this. Any good book that discusses quantum physics will discuss this experiment. But for those of you out there that haven't, you really should hear more about this because it really gets to what is going on in our minds and the way we interact with the world. The experiment involves projecting things such as quantum particles through a barrier that has two small holes in it and measuring the way that they are detected after they come through these openings. Pretty simple idea. In a common sense would suggest that when things start out on one side as particles, they would travel through the experiment in that form and end as particles. The evidence, however, shows something quite extraordinary happens. At some point between the place where the particles begin and where they finish, scientists have found when an electron, for example, passes through the barrier with only one opening available, it behaves in just the way we'd expect. It begins and ends its journey as a particle. And in doing so, there are no surprises. When a single opening is available in the barrier, the particle behaves just as we'd expect. In contrast, when two slits are used, the same electron does something that sounds impossible. Although it definitely begins its journey as a particle, a mysterious event happens along the way. The electron passes through both slits at the same time, as only a wave of energy can do, forming the kind of pattern on the target that only an energy wave can make. This is one example of the kind of behavior that scientists like to call quantum weirdness. The only explanation is the second opening has somehow forced the electron to travel as if it was a wave, and it arrives at its destination just the way it began as a particle. To do so, the electron has to somehow perceive the second opening exists. This is where the role of consciousness becomes in, because it assumes the electron cannot really know anything in the truest sense of the word. The only other source of the awareness is the person watching the experiment. And when they started to monitor what was happening, when the electrons passed through these double slits and acted like waves, they started to observe on the other side. And through the process of observation, those particles would not act like waves. They would act like particles. And it was undeniable there was an observer effect involved, that observing the particle collapses the wave. That's basically what I'm trying to get at. There's been many different ways they've tried this experiment. Historically, scientists tried to explain it, and there are several different theories that have come from this. And there's several possibilities. You know, first, there's John Kramer's transactional interpretation, which is essentially there's a handshake between future and past. Kramer's transactional interpretation of quantum physics suggests that handshakes take place between quantum particles in different points in time and space, according to Sue Ann Larson. In Kramer's interpretation, a particle here and now on Earth instantaneously communicates with particles light years away in time and space, as one particle sends an offer wave and another responds with a confirmation wave. The theory that fascinates me is Hugh Everett's many worlds interpretation. Hugh Everett, I believe he was a research assistant at the University of Cambridge, he proposed that every possibility inherent in each wave function is actually real. All of them actually occur. Possibilities become actualities with each measurement that is made, and infinitely slightly different realities come into existence as each quantum event is observed. All possibilities are equally real in a multiverse. Parallel universes coexist side by side, undetected by one another. Then there is David Bohm's holographic interpretation, which is David Bohm, a Stanford University neurophysiologist, Carl Prebram proposed that the universe may be like a giant hologram containing both matter and consciousness as a single field. The model suggests the objective world out there is a vast ocean of waves and frequencies which appear solid to us because of our brains convert the enfolded hologram into unfolded physical material. And we can perceive through our senses, as the English poet William Blake explains, see a world in a grain of sand. And then the final theory is that we can discuss, and there's many more, is Niels Bohr's Copenhagen interpretation, which is that some people call popping the quiff or collapsing the wave function. The Copenhagen interpretation of quantum physics was first described and presented by Niels Bohr in Italy in 1927. Bohr suggested that quantum particles exist as waves, which might be anywhere until the wave function is collapsed. As long as nobody looks, each quantum particle is equally distributed in a series of overlapping probability waves in a superposition of states. An observer is required to assist in ensuring quantum choices are made. All of these different things are happening. The holographic multiverse interpretation, many different parallel worlds exist, assert that the global multiverse represented by many worlds within a single holographic superstructure, providing enclosed universes with boundaries. All of these kind of point to the idea that either by information or reality, there are parallel universes, and at the same time that there's an alternate space. When these electrons disappear and move, they're going somewhere else, and they exist as probabilities. These probability waves exist so that we can actually predict the future and past. They know all the probabilities of whatever will happen, all the way to the end of time, all the way back to the beginning of time. And so what's happening is there is a place, there is a source of energy that knows all of this information. Many of us can actually see evidence of God with this source. One incredible book to read is The Field by Lynn McTaggart, The Quest for the Secret Force of the Universe. Another is David Wilcock's Source Field Investigations. And the idea is that there is an energy that's interacting with these particles, that these particles that we're talking about, the way they act in superposition, is in coexistence with some kind of energy that knows and is aware of all these probabilities. You talk to a lot of quantum physicists, when I start to talk about things like the law of attraction and the mind, they will immediately push me away. There's this idea that this quantum weirdness that we see is only seen on the microscopic scale. But more and more, we're starting to see quantum weirdness on the macro scale. There are many types of behaviors exhibited at the quantum level that we don't expect to see at the macro scale, because we are unaware of being readily able to observe them with our ordinary senses. Our perception of our world in this new quantum age is about to undergo something on par with the Copernican Revolution, according to Cynthia Sue Larson. In the Copernican Revolution of the 16th century, most people changed their mental model of the solar system, envisioning the sun and the planets revolving around the Earth. Imagine what happened going all the way back to the beginning of language when we first started talking. These were huge revolutions that occurred. And in my belief, we're about to go through a quantum revolution where we're starting to understand multiple probabilities exist at the same time. And there is this alternate space that we can access. We're starting to have quantum supercomputers using qubits that can evaluate massive large numbers of probabilities, and we can predict weather patterns when we haven't in the past. We can predict incredible amounts of information by using these quantum computers. My theory on this is that our minds are multidimensional and a quantum interface. And every second we are constantly making choices, and each choice breaks off into another universe. It is likely that most of these universes are exactly the same. In most of these universes, you're making the same choices. In my belief, the way that I see it, the way I feel it, there's probably several universes existing, but most of them collapse back to a very, very, very similar reality, which we would not be aware of or know of. But we're going to start seeing these concepts of quantum physics in our everyday life. There's the idea of quantum coherence. It's a basic principle in quantum mechanics by which, given quantum system, all parts of the system remain in perfect synchronization with one another. And that's why, even though we are made up of these different electrons and quantum material, where there is a quantum coherence that occurs, and they all act the same. Even though we think that it's on a microscopic scale, the quantum coherence idea gives an idea that large objects, humanity, huge movements can act the same as something on the small microscopic scale. Another hugely fascinating discovery with quantum physics is the idea of quantum entanglement, something that Einstein referred to as spooky action from a distance. When you can have two electrons or protons, and when they are entangled, they will act in the same way. When they rotate in the same way. Light years apart, they can still act in the same way, faster than light. They act as if they are part of the same system, in the same idea of quantum coherence. Another very fascinating idea is quantum tunneling, which is a quantum mechanical effect in which particles have a finite probability of crossing an energy barrier. Such energy is needed to break a bond with another particle, even when the quantum particle's energy is less than the energy barrier. Because matter is both particle and wave, something can exist on one side of the barrier, then exist in an energy waveform, and then be observed on the other side of the barrier. They're even going beyond to things like quantum teleportation. It's the idea of instantaneous transference of properties from one quantum system to another without physical contact. All of these different things we're starting to see examples of on a macroscopic scale. And I am absolutely fascinated by this. It's something that we're going to see more and more. That's all of the lecturing and background I wanted to give you. But when you start to consider this, the idea of the observer collapsing a wave function tells us the power of our attention is absolutely amazing. When you pay attention, observe an object, you may be collapsing that wave function. You know, Einstein used to joke, does the moon exist if we aren't looking at it? And, you know, we don't know. Most people, the moon is always going to be there because there's always observers, even outside of our solar system. So when you think about larger objects, what is the observer? What is the measurer? There's things like that. And it's easy to joke about this stuff, but on a macroscopic scale, you're collapsing wave functions all the time. When you focus on anger, you're going to collapse wave functions. You're going to start to see more anger. The idea that you start to see and experience more things as your emotions and your mind interacts on a quantum level with your environment. Of course, these ideas are going to be questioned. And I'm telling you to question the ideas that I'm coming up with. And as I discuss some behaviors and techniques, some things that you can do to test this out, that's probably the best way for you to understand it. You don't even need to truly understand this stuff. The idea is, it is probable that there are multiple parallel realities, and at a minimum, there is an information field which contains information about all of the multiple probable parallel realities around us. There has been several books in a genre that have started to come out discussing the idea of parallel realities and moving through these parallel worlds to achieve goals, dreams, change your life. And it kind of unlocks this idea that we can do anything, that anything is possible. We have this one, which is Moving Through Parallel Worlds to Achieve Your Dreams by Kevin Michelle. And then Vadim Zeland's Reality Transurfing, a truly remarkable book. And then there is Frederick Dodson's Parallel Universes of Self, another book I highly recommend. The bottom line with this is, as Frederick Dodson kind of indicates in his book, life becomes way more interesting once you realize there are many versions of yourself and millions of options that await you. He gives an example in his book, Parallel Universes of Self. Think of parallel realities like multiple highways going at the same time, coming from one destination, going to another destination. The example that he gives, imagine hundreds of highways side by side stretching before you while these highways lead to or come from destinations. The highways are ultimate destinations, the starting or ending point of the highway. Each highway represents a unique life experience. Each represents a different version of you. Each highway contains experiences, props, people, sceneries, backgrounds, and emotions that are distinct and different. Although on some, there may be similarities. Each time you make a change or a decision, you change direction. You may move forward, backwards, to the right, to the left, or even switch to another highway altogether. From that viewpoint, infinity, these highways are not actually beside each other, nor are they stacked on top of each other. From that viewpoint of infinity, they all take up the same space at the same time. So people have started to discuss, well, even if that's true, it's impossible for us to really move to another parallel reality. Scientists have tried to discuss, how could we do this? If you read Michio Kaku's book, Parallel Worlds, he discusses the idea of decoherence and coherence. And if one parallel world has a vibratory level that's similar to another, they may be closer at the same level and you may be able to move into the other. He gives an analogy of trap doors. It's like falling through a trap door on a stage that would move you into another world. Some of these analogies, it's harder to understand. Another incredible book by Cynthia Sue Larson is Quantum Jumps. And she has another one called Reality Shifts. And just a remarkable book that she talks about her own personal experiences of quantum jumping. Now, in physics, there's this idea of quantum jumping, which when electrons are going around an atom, if they get a sufficient amount of energy, they will jump to another place. These electrons exist as a cloud. In the 80s, they started to witness an electron blink out and move to another level. And with a sufficient amount of energy, there's a quantum jump. And in her book, she's talking about the idea of, we do quantum jumps. We move and jump into these parallel realities. And it's very fascinating. Cynthia Sue Larson, she's a physicist at Stanford, and she gives multiple examples of this kind of thing. And she even takes surveys of different people that have seen these kind of reality shifts. They've seen objects travel distances. 33% saw people, plants, and animals disappear. 27% have seen dead people, animals alive again. 14% have seen reality shifts on a daily basis. 21% notice reality shifts monthly. She even gives a story in her book of her and her friend seeing a sundial on the Berkeley campus just appear and look as if it had been there forever, just appear out of nowhere. We're seeing objects and things move. Who knows if this stuff is real or if this is just some kind of collective hallucination that we're experiencing. But there may be something to it, as I saw in my life. Obviously, something is going on in our collective unconsciousness. There are so many movies. If you watch Netflix, you watch on television, there have been so many different movies and comic books and books that have been dedicated to the idea of parallel realities. Just look at the series Fringe, one of my favorite, is discussing the idea that there is this parallel reality that is interacting with ours. And we've seen it on multiple cases and in different places. If you read about it, it becomes more and more fascinating. There is a very fascinating story that ended up on Reddit. A woman named Lorena Garcia woke up. The sheets that she had were different. She goes to work and she discovers that she works in a different office than she thought. Her boyfriend is not her boyfriend. The place where her office is located is different. Tons of different changes, and she started to suspect she had gone into a parallel universe. And so that interests me when I see that. Maybe, for instance, it's some kind of confirmation bias that I'm seeing this. I don't believe so. There's another very fascinating story that you can find on YouTube about the man from Torad. There was a man that landed in an airport that had paperwork and documentation that he came from a country called Torad. There was no record of this country. They could not find any record. He absolutely claimed that he had come from this country. They took him to a hotel room and let him stay overnight. And then the next day when they went to his hotel room, he had disappeared. Now, who knows if this stuff is real? How do we know what's going on when we dream? When we dream, are we witnessing some version of these alternate spaces or parallel realities? I don't know. Another interesting concept when you start to look at quantum physics is the idea that linear time is wrong. The idea that A to B to C is how we exist in the universe. And as Einstein pointed out, time is relative. But it's better to understand and look at time like a lake. And when an event happens, say you throw a pebble into the lake, it will radiate out in circular waves. And the biggest take back from this is that these waves go backwards and forwards in the future. Using this concept, Lynn McTaggart, in her book, The Intention Experiment, discusses a study in which people had created intentions and tried to pray for people in the past, and had found that the people that they had prayed for to have better health actually showed a significant improvement in their health. There have been other studies that have tried to get this idea of future history and going back into our past. So when I was researching this stuff, I found it very fascinating, and I tried to do meditations where I went back in time. And after the event happened, where I had this home invasion, I had a deep meditation where I tried to go back and visit myself when this was happening. When I originally had this happen, I heard a voice in my ear and it sounded like my voice. And so I did the same things. I guided myself, and it probably was just me re-experiencing what happened, but it felt real. I felt like I was guiding myself. Shut the porch door before he shoots. Run this direction. There's going to be someone there. Pull your head back. I almost did this because I felt like I better, just in case. That's the reason I had survived. But Frederick Dodson gives an example of this. And when you get an idea of these future and past waves, there are quantum waves that have been theorized and have not quite been proven yet. But let me ask you a question. Have you ever noticed when we look at major events such as 9/11, people not going on the planes, not going into the buildings, major train accidents where people get a feeling and they don't go on the train, there is something going on where perhaps you are aware in some parallel universe that you had something tragic happen with a plane accident or a train accident. And so your mind becomes aware of these waves that are coming from the future. And so people that are very intuitive may be simply becoming aware of these waves, of quantum waves of future and past. In fact, A version of this idea was advanced by Adrian Dobbs, a mathematician and physicist at the University of Cambridge in 1965. He stated, as events unfold, he proposed that actualize a relatively small number of possibilities for change that exist at a subatomic level. In the process, disturbances are caused that create, in another dimension of time, what Dobbs calls a cytronic wave front. The wavefront can be recognized by the brain's neurons, at least in certain especially sensitive people, and interpreted. A metaphor may help clarify the process. Imagine a pond at one side of which a toy ship is launched. At the other side of the pond is a very small person. He is unable to see the ship, but as the ship travels forward, the waves it makes reach the shore on which he stands. As they travel across the pond, these waves pass around certain objects, weeds, leaves, and logs, that are fixed or slowly drifting on the surface. The objects thus create disturbances in the wavefront, which the small person who has lifetimes experiencing these things is able to note in fine detail. There have been studies that have shown that a significantly smaller number of people die in train accidents. In fact, there is several books that have been written about this, and there is a significant correlation to large accidents happening and people avoiding these accidents. Perhaps something is going on that's related to cytronic wave fronts on the subatomic level. So that's a crazy idea, but understand there might be something going on. As I started to experiment with this idea, I was reading an incredible book called Mega Brain Power. Michael Hutchinson discusses using flotation tanks and going for longer than 90 minutes. He notices waves come in. And so I tried to experiment with this, you know, trying flotation tanks. And I did experience every 90 minutes a wave coming in. And perhaps we have waves coming in from the future and past that we're collapsing into reality all the time. And if we narrow our focus, create an intention for a future that we want, we can find a parallel reality where we are successful in what we want to do, where we achieve the goals that we have. And as a result, this particular event will happen. I find this fascinating. It's something that I want to discuss more. The idea that we can hack our reality, that we can unlock our future, and we can unleash our potential, which is what we believe with the reality revolution. I would love to hear your perspective about this. Please let me know if you've had experiences where you might have shifted into different realities and you've noticed different things happening. And if that's the case, I want to know about it. I want to hear your perspective. Email me at brian@advancedsuccessinstitute.com. I would love to talk about it. In our next podcast, we're going to discuss Vadim Zeland's reality transurfing, an idea that's discussed extensively on Aaron Doty's YouTube channel. I find it very fascinating. And we will discuss all of the genre and the different literature that's been created about quantum jumping and reality transurfing, and we're going to discuss ways that we can utilize these things that we've learned and how we can maneuver through these parallel realities to achieve goals and create miracles in our life. And I would love to hear your perspective on this. So please email me at brian@advancedsuccessinstitute.com. If you're interested in advertising with our podcast, you can email me there as well. I am so excited to discuss this stuff further. We're going to also discuss different things like law of attraction. We're going to discuss the reticular activating system, how to hack your subconscious mind, how to unleash wealth in your life, how to unlock love in your future, using some of these concepts and more concepts. We want to take this to the next level. We want to know what are the advanced ways of us understanding why this stuff happens so that we can make better use of our environment around us. We want to discuss this stuff even more. So it has just been an honor that you came and listened to me, and I can't wait to talk more about this. Thank you for tuning into the Reality Revolution podcast. Please join the Reality Revolution today.